Hi, my name is Manuel Lucani. I am Dean and Professor at CTOR Academy, and I'd like to welcome you to CTOR channel. The topic of today's discussion is equivalent system. Let's start today's discussion with one simple question. If we apply a force on a tooth, how much the tooth moves? Well, of course, we discussed that the movement of the tooth, the magnitude of the movement depends on the magnitude of the force that we are applying and duration of application of force. But that's not my question today. How I can measure the distance that the tooth moves? Let's look at the example. If I apply a force on a tooth at the level of center of resistance, we discussed that the tooth will move along the line of action. In this example, all the points along the tooth move in the same distance. If you measure it based on apex, measure it at the level of center of resistance, or measure it at the level of crown, you come with the same number. That's the magnitude of the movement of the tooth in response to your force. But what happens if I apply a force at the level of the crown? This time, you will notice that not all the points in the tooth move in the same magnitude. Some move more and some move less. If I'm looking at another example, if I'm applying a force on the crown, you will notice that the movement of the crown usually is more than the movement of center of resistance, and sometimes apex is actually moves in opposite direction. So which one of these distances are representative of movement of our teeth? You may say, well, the crown, because it's more clinically relevant. But can we communicate with each other about the crown movement? It's very difficult. Which point of the crown you are measuring it? Mesial side, distal side, incisal edge, what happened that part tilt? So that's not a very clear point. It would be nice if we have one point that we can measure the distance based on that. If you remember from previous discussion, we said that every object in the universe is representative by center of gravity as one point. It's the average of all the points of the tooth become one point. The same thing with the center of resistance. If the object is restrained, like tooth, we can summarize all the points. We have one representative of the tooth, and that would be the center of resistance. So maybe we should measure the movement based on center of resistance. Let's look at this example. If I'm applying a force on the occlusal surface of the molar, but I apply it a little bit more in the buccal side, you will say, well, the tooth is going to move. And let's measure the distance from the center of resistance. And that would be the D. What happens if I apply the force, same force, at the level of center of resistance? As we talked before, the movement should be the same. In another word, the point, the center of resistance, the representative of the object, should move the same amount. And it does. That's also D. And what happened if I decided to apply the force at the palatal side? Again, the object moves the same magnitude, D. However, in the top part of the slide and bottom part of the slide, there was some sort of a rotation also in the system. And we discussed that last time, that is because of the moment, the tendency for rotation appears. The amount of the movement in response to the same magnitude of the force is the same, and it should be measured based on center of resistance. Is this important? Very important. Let's test that. Assume I decided to intrude these two teeth. One of them is more proclined, a central. One of them is more upright. And I apply exactly the same amount of the force. In your experience, you will say, if you apply the force on the right side of the screen, because it is more proclined, I should have more movement. On the other hand, in the left side, because the tooth is upright, you experience that it seems the movement is less. While in reality, both center of resistance receive the same force, therefore they should move the same. However, one of them, because it's farther from the center of resistance, has more tendency for rotation, while the other one has less tendency for rotation. Therefore, the crown movement would be different. Of course, clinically you can see that. But actually the tooth move the same, which means the center of resistance of the tooth move the same. So in the left side, if I say the distance between the force and the center of resistance is D, you can see a moment appear in our system and the tooth not only intrude, but slightly clockwise rotates. In the right side of the screen, if the, again, the distance between the force and center of resistance, now this time is bigger, let's call it D2, and I apply the same force, same magnitude of the force, you would say the center of resistance goes up, but at the same time, it will rotate more. And that's because of the moment that appears in the system that is equal to the magnitude of the force times the distance. In another word, we can divide every movement to two parts. Let's call the one that is moves along the line of action displacement. So the center of resistance response to the force is displacement of center of resistance along the line of action. And then the second part is a rotation. That is the response to side effect of force not passing through the center of resistance. Remember, the total energy of your system has not changed. It's just distribution of the energy has changed. So if you look at the left side of the screen, you will see if there is a tooth that a force applies at the crown level, and assume it is 100 centinewton. With a 10 millimeter distance from the center of resistance, a moment appear in the system that would be 1000 centinewton millimeter. I can say this system is equal to a tooth that receives a force at center of resistance, that is 100 centinewton, force is the same, and receive a rotation of 1000 centinewton millimeters. So what I did, I just separate displacement and rotation component of my movement and I draw it at the center of resistance. In that case, you don't get confused how much crown moves, how much apex moves, you know what components are in your system. This is very important when we are measuring tooth movement, especially in our studies. If you don't measure or define where you are measuring it from, it's actually conclusion of that study would be very difficult to make. So assume I have a tooth and I apply a force of 100 centinewton and 50 centinewton in opposite direction with different distance from the center of resistance. Of course, they're producing opposite moments. Wouldn't it be simpler that instead of all these forces and moment, I calculate what is the total force, what is the total moment, and just draw the final force and final moment at the level of center of resistance? It's almost like just we apply one force, and that force, because of a distance from the center of resistance, had one moment. And based on the amount of the magnitude of the moment, and direction of the moment and magnitude of the force, you can draw the displacement part of the movement, then draw the rotation part of the movement, and you can say, wow, that's the final position of the tooth, without being confused. If you decided to not use the equivalent system for drawing your movement or defining your movement, you need to be very precise in defining where you are measuring your movement from. And in that measurement, you need to clarify which part of it is displacement and which one is rotation. It's a very difficult thing to do. While the center of resistance and equivalent system made the system very simple. Let's look at a different example for equivalent system. If I ask you that I apply a force at the buccal side of this molar, what are you expecting to see? I'm going to draw the equivalent system at the center of resistance. And you can see that there is a force. You just transfer the same force to the center of resistance and you see the component moment that this force has. And as I explained, as a clinical trick to want to see what is the direction of the moment, just bend your arrow around the center of resistance and that would be your moment. The magnitude of it, of course, depends on the distance between the force and center of resistance. So that would be the equivalent system of this molar. How about this one? What would be the equivalent system if I apply intrusion force on this molar at the buccal level? Well, you will say, I'm going to transfer the force to the center of resistance, and then I'm going to draw an arrow that shows the moment that I have in my system, and that shows that we have a displacement down and we have a rotation counterclockwise. If you having equivalent system, you decided to use it, in each dimension you need to draw it separately. For example, equivalent system in this system, in this premolar, in response to application of the force, would be different if we're looking at occlusal view. So don't think that with drawing one equivalent system, you already address all the problems of all the dimensions. Thank you for listening to another session of CTOR channel. The topic for next discussion would be couple. If you are interested to learn about couple, keep watching.